Okay, I have 6 o'clock. So I would like to convene this meeting of a special meeting of the Board of Directors of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District on July 8th, 2021. Holly, can you call the roll, please?
President Mayhood?
Here.
Vice President Henry?
Here.
Director Ackman?
Here.
Director Fulce?
Here.
Director Smalley?
Here.
Okay. Are there any additions or deletions to the agenda?
The staff has none.
Okay. All right. Then we will move on to oral communications. This is a time when members of the public may address the board on any topic under its purview, except for those things that are on the agenda tonight. I see we have 3 people in attendance from the public. Would anybody like to ask a question or make a statement at this point? Seeing none, hearing none, then I guess we'll just go right on to new business. The first item being the response to the City of Santa Cruz petition for change of their water rights and our response to them. And I'll turn it over to Rick or Gina. Yeah,
just before I'm going to turn this over to District Council for presentation, but just for information, I received a phone call today from Rosemary Menard, the director of the City of Santa Cruz Water Department, just to let us know that she will be attending tonight's meeting, not intending to speak, but would be more than happy to answer any questions from the board. And with that, I'll ask District Council to present this item to the board.
Thank you, Chair Mayhood. Thank you, District Manager Rogers. This item, I think, won't come as a surprise to anybody on the board. Most of the materials that were presented in your agenda packet were previously presented back in March of this year in connection with the district's receipt of the City of notice of the City of Santa Cruz's water rights petitions. And we took a close look and provided a presentation to the board at that time regarding those petitions and potential interactions with the district's water rights. And the district considered a couple of issues that were of importance to the district and its rights, namely with respect to the district's ability to call upon its Loch Lomond entitlement, and also interactions between the district's Felton right and the City of Santa Cruz's proposed changes to its water rights that both have similar flow conditions measured at the Big Trees gauge on the San Lorenzo River. So the district did submit the protest after talking to the representatives of the City of Santa Cruz and their water rights council about the district's plans to do so. In May, the district received a letter from the city's water rights council responding to our protest and presenting what appeared to be some constructive suggestions for how to resolve the 2 elements of the protest. And that letter from the city's water rights council is in your packet. And having reviewed that letter, the district has prepared a response that proposes a couple of minor tweaks to what the city suggested that hopefully can come, if not resolve the protest, come very close to doing so. And of course, the gist of the tweaks that we've proposed to the city's suggestions for a resolution are right along the lines of what we've previously discussed. The key issue with the Loch Lomond rights, the timing of the abilities of the district's ability to call upon those rights, that's a critical issue. The district is most likely to need those rights either for use or for its own use or for conjunctive use during times when water supplies are limited. And so there's a strong concern to make sure that the permit, that the water rights permit, doesn't preclude that water from being called upon when it's needed. And with respect to the Big Trees gauge, the concern is that if that same requirement that the city is proposing for its water rights were imported directly into the district's water right, or directly or indirectly to apply to the district's water rights, it could seriously impair the district's ability to utilize those Felton water rights. And there are proposals that are being developed right now to make changes to those water rights so that they can be, their use can be maximized in conjunction for conjunctive use within the valley. And so there's a need to ensure that the city's changes don't end up interfering with other changes that are needed by the district and other water users in the valley going forward. So that's the gist of the changes that you see in the letter that was presented to you. You should also be aware, I'm sure you saw in the memo, that the city has released its environmental impact report for its water rights petitions. And there are a couple of public hearings coming up on that EIR, and comments are currently due on July 26th. So that's something that we're looking at as well, that bears on the water rights petitions, but it's not directly implicated in the draft letter that's in front of you. And we're not seeking board approval of the letter, but did want to present it and hear your concerns related to it, because of course this is an important issue for the district. And the hope, I believe, Rick, is that once this letter goes to the city, that there could be a meeting for the city and the district to sit down and bridge any gap that may remain between what the city's proposal was and what our response is.
That's correct. In my conversation today with Rosemary Menard, the director of City of Santa Cruz Water, that felt it would be advantageous for the two districts to sit down face to face and give the city a better understanding of our concerns and to talk about the district's what our district operations look like moving forward. And I agree that anytime that we can sit down and discuss issues put our cards on the table and get a better understanding, it'd be worth our time.
And with that, happy to answer any questions that the board may have about the proposed response.
Okay, I'll just mention that the board did see this draft, and so this is not a night to do wordsmithing here. We've had plenty of time to look at it, so hopefully we can just move to basically give our seal of approval on it. But as I understand, you don't want to vote on this, right? So, but anyway, are there any questions or comments from the board? Jamie?
Yeah, I'm just, if we could talk a little bit about, because I didn't really understand the decision matrix to, there was some discussion around moving the gauge location, the Big Trees gauge location, as the location where the measurements are taken. And I'm just wondering if we, you know, how much of this is mitigated if that is one of the resolutions that is accepted?
Well, I'll try to answer that, and Rick or Carly may want to jump in as well. But the idea here wouldn't be that there would be no flow requirements connected to Felton. The idea, there are already flow requirements measured further upstream with respect to the Felton rights. So the issue would be sort of decoupling the SLV Felton rights from the same metric that's applying to the city's rights. But nobody is proposing that there shouldn't be any, you know, limitations on maintaining sufficient flows in the river for purposes of fisheries. You may note one of the comments in the letter is that, of course, you know, if you move the measuring point for bypass flows or flow requirements upstream, you know, you can't just move it as a practical matter. If you're measuring it somewhere else, there's going to be a different amount of flow that should be associated with that point. And so it complicates the ability to simply say, well, we'll just move the big tree's measuring point upstream. It's going to have to be a little more nuanced than that, or it's going to have to rely on the district's existing flow requirements further upstream on the Felton rights. So that's, if you saw the language that suggested that the solution may be a little more nuanced than simply moving the big tree's measuring point upstream, that's why.
Okay, is that, Bob, go ahead.
Yeah, we've talked about these issues before. Just really quickly to summarize my concerns about them is, I think it's great that Santa Cruz wants to, I think in their words, perfect their water rights, but they need to do so within the confines of their own operations. So if they want to have a 40 CFS bypass flow, then they have to deliver the 40 CFS bypass flow. We would be additive to that if on any bypass flows that we might get stuck with as part of this. So I just don't want to be part of their process on that. And I think Gina, the letter, I think makes that pretty clear. The same thing on the Loch Lomond water. We don't want a missing comma to impact our ability to draw on that water. That needs to be well understood and well documented that when we get ready to draw on it, we should be able to draw on it at any time. So please carry those into the conversations that you have with Rosemary Menard this coming week or whenever you have those. Thanks.
Mark?
Yes, I was pleased to see that the city was willing to make some amendments to their petition. And I'm glad to see that with some very limited changes, we can agree to that language with the changes that are in the response letter back from Gina. So I think this is positive that we're able to move forward and that the city is willing to make some modifications based on the district's concerns. And I would hope that with these limited changes that we are suggesting, that the city can now say, yes, we can accept those and we can move forward on this. So I don't have any further concerns with this. It looks good to me. Okay.
Lois, you had your hand up?
Yeah. I get that the city wants to save the fish, but they're never going to come back like they were in the 70s. And to double the flow that's been what the state has been happy with for years just seems unreasonable to me. And it affects us adversely. So they cannot affect our flow. That's the way I feel about it.
Well, I guess I would just say I agree with kind of what everybody said here. And I'm hoping that Mark is right and that Santa Cruz can accept those changes. Won't surprise me if they won't, but I'm hopeful. And I thought that Gina did a good job of trying to make sure that there wasn't any wiggle room that could hurt us later on while being cordial and friendly about it. And so I was quite happy with the letter myself. Rick?
Just in response to Director Fultz's comment that, you know, we want to be able to take our Loch Lomond contract water when we want to. And that's generally the belief from SLB and from Santa Cruz. But we will have to work out nuances down the road of how to deal with Santa Cruz's operational the way they operate their water system, because there are times when there may not be Loch Lomond water in that pipeline when they're doing maintenance, or depending on how they operate their diversions. And I think that's very understandable, but you know, staffs will just have to work those out. But there will be times when we'll have to work around Santa Cruz's operational of their intake and intake structures.
Of course.
Right.
I'll go out now to members of the public. I see that Mark Lee has his hand up. Mark, would you like to comment? Mark, you should be able to speak to us.
I'm sorry. I thought I was unmuted. I'd like to full 3 minutes here if I could please. The letter was well written by Gina. I appreciate the clarity, but when you refer to the wiggle room, I think you're being quite naive with who we're dealing with at the city. Have you read, I want to ask every one of the people on the board here, have you read the EIR? Rick, have you read the EIR?
I have not.
Okay, so you really don't know the gravity of what is going on here. Lois, have you read the EIR? Lois, have you read the EIR?
I hear you. Speak English and not give me an EIR.
Okay, environmental impact report, the one that's the subject of this letter. Bob, have you read it yet?
No.
Jamie?
You know, Mark, given your expertise in this area, I'd be very interested in hearing what you have to say about it. Don't spend your 3 minutes querying the board.
So anyway, I understand you're dealing with also an attorney who I went to school with at Davis by the name of Steve Cronick. He's one of my closest friends. I hate to see him on the opposite side of the table, but the EIR is completely inadequate. They're saying they are giving absolutely no credibility to growth inducement. They indicate in the EIR document there's going to be a $1.2 billion deficit that they plan on. Once these diversion rights are accepted, they're going to be expanding those rights. You need to read the EIR. In fact, I'm surprised. I think you should. If they do not go along with this language, I think you should. My advice is, Gina, we need more teeth in this with the nuances, so we hold their feet to the agreement. Because once you're gone, you're in LA, Steve is in Sacramento, and the board changes, they're not going to remember this. We need to have performance criteria on this recommended letter. And I don't, it's very nice, it's very accommodating, but they're going to, especially on the language on term 13, it refers to, you know, trying to come up with some kind of mitigation measures that you hope that they will agree to. So I know you're trying to avoid litigation, but this is no way to enter the lion's den for those people in Santa Cruz. I know who you are dealing with down there. They have no intention of complying with this agreement. So I would recommend everyone read the EIR. In fact, the EIR is grossly inadequate and should be the city, the in your comments during the draft period, and I hope you're going to be attending the meetings, look at it, read the 80 page and read the growth inducements. And also, Bob, read the ASR chapter on how this water is going to be sent. Millions of gallons are going to be sent to the Soquel Water District for an ASR pilot project. Okay. And it's, so this letter does not address specifically the issues that we really need to address. Thank you. I hope you will amend the letter.
Thank you. Jim Mosher?
Yes, I didn't have a chance to read the letter until the meeting started. I didn't realize it was online, so I don't have any comments on that. And one part of what Mark said, I would agree with, which is it would be helpful for me at least, and I think for the public, if we did have some kind of analysis of the EIR. I have not read it. It's an area that I don't have any expertise in, but I'm hoping the board can give the public some guidance about the what's in that EIR. The city has approached the Friends of the San Lorenzo Valley Water, wanting to present to us and telling us how wonderful the EIR is in terms of protecting the fish and the environment. But there is a fair amount of suspicion in the valley about what they're up to in terms of the growth down there. And it would be just helpful if we had some guidance as to how to interpret what they're doing and how we should approach it as your constituents. Thank you.
Carly, would you like to respond to that?
Sure. I'd be happy to try to put together a simple summary of the EIR. There's also, City of Santa Cruz did put together their own community report, kind of talking about the different findings in the EIR and what they were looking to do with their water right changes. And that's available on their website as well. But something coming from the district is probably also a good thing to do.
Bob?
I actually have a clarifying question for Mark and Jim. And that is, just to make sure I'm understanding what you're advocating, are you advocating that our district and this board take a position that would be against the kind of growth that Santa Cruz expects to have in their city population and housing stock and commercial stock and that sort of thing? Is that what's being asked?
Jim, go ahead and respond.
Bob, no, that's at least not what I'm asking for. I'm just asking for some guidance in interpreting it. You know, I understand we need to be working regionally. We're facing the drought and climate change, and it's important for the district to work collaboratively with the other districts in the area. I am, because of the distrust that we have in the valley of what the city's up to, I would just like some guidance as to whether or not the EIR is adequately and accurately describing the potential damage that could happen to our watershed. It's just not an area of expertise, and I would like to have some kind of independent review of that, someone looking at it from the point of view of the valley rather than from the city.
Mark?
Great. I know that's turnaround on the normal process, but thank you, Jim, for clarifying that.
Mark?
Yes, I agree with what Jim just said. I appreciate that the city has put together their synopsis of what they believe the EIR says. Carly, I want to see what the district's perspective is on that, not the city's in particular. So,
and our review of the EIR would be looking at it as its impacts to San Lorenzo Valley.
Agreed. Yes.
I just want to make clear of that.
Yes.
Bob, did you have something more you wanted to say on that?
Well, just a real quick question, and I think this is for Rick. Is it possible to have that hour summary completed before Santa Cruz's first meeting, which I believe is the 14th, a week from now, almost a week from now?
We'll if we don't already have, we'll get the or take a look at it, see what type of bandwidth lift it would be, because I'd recommend it be myself, Carly, and district council, and we all bring different expertise to the table, and take a look at it. And this would be a look as it affects the San Lorenzo Valley Water District or what concerns we would have. I'd have to look at dates of meetings and so forth, but we could make it a high priority and make some deadlines.
I believe their first meeting is the 14th. And would we share this with that summary with Rosemary Menard and the Santa Cruz City Water Department.
Yeah, no problem with that.
Great. I think that'd be fabulous. That way they can just address it at the meetings on the 14th and the 20th. If they wish to.
Make formal comments. It would be due by July 26th, just so the group knows.
I'm sorry, Carly, you said that the comment period ends on the 26th of July, so we need to, okay.
Well, just to be clear, it would be great if Santa Cruz Water Department could address those at their community meetings, any concerns that we might have. And those meetings, I believe, are on the 14th and 20th. I do understand the formal period is the 26th, but I'd rather have them talk about our concerns during those meetings.
It would be good if we had our concerns and if we were going to meet with Santa Cruz to discuss those. And I'll work with Gina and Carly here and then we'll put together a plan.
Okay, that sounds good. Beth, I thought I saw your hand up, but it looks like it went back down or you know, it's back up again. Okay, did you have a comment? Go ahead.
Oh, thanks. I just want to say that I agree it would be really helpful. I also think it would be helpful for all of us in the community on the board to you know, think about how this could be and could impact the Santa Margarita water process. You know, I think that the other water districts are going to pay attention to how much we're paying attention.
Any other comments? Gina, do you need anything from us or what would you like?
I do not. The letter will be sent tomorrow. I believe the city's, frankly, has already seen it. And then Rick, I believe the next step will be to promptly set up a meeting with the city to discuss it.
Right. And as I said at the beginning of the meeting, Rosemary Menard has offered and thinks that would be a good idea. I guess my questions to the board attendance of that meeting would be myself, district council, and chair Mahood. What does that sound like? And possibly Carly would be representing SLV. Does that work for the board?
I think it will be helpful to have either me or Mark there because of the association with this all kind of plays into the Santa Margarita stuff and, you know, water that they take out of the valley. This is something that Mark and I talked a long time ago about before this all started when I first brought up the issues that I was concerned about what they were saying. Ultimately, we can't really tell them what to do with their water. It's their water, but there are certain things we can make sure is that they don't make a mess in Felton, putting in new pipelines and things like that. So, it's a little bit of a dance here because I don't want to overstate our what we can do to influence them, but I think it would be good to have either Mark or I involved in terms of the
same goes for, you know, SOB explaining our operations and what we're looking at going down the road and to explain our concerns face to face. I think that would go a long ways with putting this to bed, so to speak.
Okay. Any other comments from the public? If not, Bob, go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to say that, you know, we're also dealing here with, I think, the same sort of divide that we kind of dealt with the possible consolidation with Scotts Valley. And that is, we are a rural, even though they classify us as urban, it's fake urban. We're a rural area with no growth. And the only growth that's going to happen is on remodels and perhaps demographic shifts. And both of those areas are urban areas, truly urban areas with higher growth in population, housing stock, commercial development, that sort of thing. And so those things are that same sort of city-country divide that you always get when those two areas sort of rub up against each other. And so it's incumbent upon all of us just to make sure that all of those concerns are out on the table. So Gail, you being there or Mark being there is absolutely the right thing to make sure that this all folds in nicely with Santa Margarita to the extent it can.
With that, we'll go on to our next order of business, which is me giving a talk about updating us on the Santa Margarita process. And I thought that it might be appropriate for me to hand over the reins of the meeting to the Vice President. Not that I think there are going to be people, you know, rioting in the streets as I talk about ASR or whatever, but it just seems proper. Well, maybe Bob will be jumping up and down, I don't know, but it just seems more proper to have me. You don't have to tell me that, Bob. I've been working on that for 3 years now. You're preaching to the choir. All right. So if she doesn't mind, I'm going to let her sort of handle questions and things. So with that, I think I'm going to try to see if I can share my screen, all right? And
Ooh, PowerPoint, Gail.
Ooh, wow, huh? All right. Whoops, let me get my laser pointer out too. All right. Yay. Okay, good. And all right, let me. So what I thought I'd do today is give an update. There's been a lot of things happening and they're all sort of coming together finally. And before I do, I just want to sort of give some acknowledgments here, and that first to the staff and the consultants who've worked on the Santa Margarita process. And I have shamelessly plagiarized all of their slides and other things here. And so I couldn't have put this together if they hadn't done that. I'd also like to thank Director Smalley, who joined the board at the same time, more or less, I did at Santa Margarita, and having him be very practically oriented and detail oriented has been a huge addition to the board for Santa Margarita. And I'd also like to give a shout out to the former SLVW reps on the board. I've been going to those meetings 2 years before I actually was elected, and I was often very impressed by the perspicaciousness of Lois's questions and the fact that she often seemed to be the only board member that was very concerned about costs. And then Lou Ferris and I both sort of realized that the problems, potential problems with ASR about the same time. And so we sort of worked together to learn more about it. I did a lot of reading, and I think he's been a big help in my thinking on this too. So as a geologist, of course, I have to start out with a map to orient us, okay? And so one of the things you can see here on this set view is that we have the San Lorenzo Valley watershed, of which the Santa Margarita, this little triangular shaped thing here, is only a part. And of course, then we have our water district and the Scotts Valley Water District here. So what I'm gonna try to shut, see if I can, what is groundwater? It's basically the water that fills pore space and fractures in sedimentary rocks. And I need to figure out a way to close my, how do I get to close the, because I see everybody and I can't read my own slides. Up in the right hand corner, maybe I can.
In the.
You want to exit full screen? I think you go to the top.
Yeah, maybe. I have a feeling I do too. Okay.
That's what I do.
All right.
So I can see everybody. Oops.
Okay. I think I'm just making it worse. Never mind, I'll just do my best. All right. Okay, can you see it now?
Yeah.
Great.
Not yet.
No?
You switched your views.
Yeah.
We see you. We don't see the presentation.
Sorry.
No good deed goes unpunished.
Right.
All right. So there. Okay. Now, can you see it?
Not yet.
All right. Let me try something. Let me try share screen again.
Yes.
There we go.
Okay. I still have, there we go. Now I can, you're right. You can't do it with a pointer. You gotta do it with a regular thing. All right, now I've got it together here. Okay, and the water table is just the top of the zone that is the groundwater zone. So what makes groundwater available is porosity and permeability, and the porosity is just the total volume of the pore space in the rocks or in the pores between the grains or the fractures. And then the other thing that controls it is the permeability, which is basically how fast water can flow through. So on the left down here, we have sands where there's big pores and it's easy for the water to snake its way through. Here, there's plenty of porosity, but the grains are so small that in this fine-grained material, it takes a long time for the water to go through. So in deposits or rocks of clay and silt size, the water travels slowly. And you've certainly experienced this if you've ever dug a hole in your backyard. And if you have clay, you sometimes have to come back the next day. If you're in the Santa Margarita, the water goes out of the hole immediately. So we have the term aquifer for that permeable layer of rock or sediment, usually sand or gravel. And the best aquifers are either sedimentary rocks or unconsolidated deposits of sand and gravel or porous limestones. Other rocks like siltstones, mudstones, and most igneous and metamorphic rocks, unless they're highly fractured, make it very hard for the water to move. And so they're called aquitards because they retard the movement of the water. And if you look around the basin, we have kind of all different kinds of those aquifers, where in the Santa Margarita, we have a very good one because it's a coarse grained sand with lots of porosity and permeability. Then in the Lompico and the Butano, we have, it's a little bit not all one size. So porosity is high, but permeability isn't quite so good, but it's still a very good aquifer. Then we do have a tiny little aquifer that's in marble. My house and about 22 others on Felton Empire Road are served by a spring coming out of fractures in marbles in the basement rocks. And then, poor folks in Big Basin are in what is not a good aquifer in fractures in granitic rock. So here are the rocks that are the stratigraphic rocks that make up our basin. So we have the Santa Margarita on the top, the Lompico, the Butano, and there's an aquitard, the Monterey Formation, that is usually between the Santa Margarita and the Lompico. Only occasionally is there a place where these two are in connection, and that's a really important one for recharge of water into the Lompico. And then in the Butano, there's three different members. The middle one is not so good because it's finer grained and it also has pyrite in it, which then if you oxidize that, releases iron and sulfur and sometimes arsenic. So these things in yellow are the ones that we generally put the things in, and these are thick units. So if you look at the Santa Margarita groundwater basin, again, this little triangular thing, it's bounded on the north by the Zayanti Fault, on the west by the Ben Lomond Fault. The boundary on the east side is sort of a transitional one and is based on the fact that there's sort of a granite high underneath there that separates this basin from mid-county. And the aquifers here, the Santa Margarita in yellow, where you can see the Quail Hollow and Olympia, Pasatiempo, is in some of those wells are in there. Then the aquitard of the Monterey, and the Lompico is only exposed just a little bit here, and then the Butano is exposed up in the high areas as you drive up into the mountains. And that strange shape of that groundwater basin is a function that we're basically on the plate margin here. We're on the Pacific plate moving away from the North American plate. And if we get in close here, we can see, so here we are here. We are between this Zayanti Fault, which is still active, the Ben Lomond Fault, which is associated with the San Andreas Fault Zone, but is probably not active anymore or not very active. And one of the interesting things about the fault here is you can see where the Loma Prieta Fault in 1989 was, is there's kind of a bend in that little fault there. And when you get those bends, what happens is that the two rock units, the two plates can't move past each other, and they kind of bonk up against each other and cause things to thrust up and over and to fold. And so that's what's happened in our area around here, is that's why we have folded rocks that make up the basin. And if you see these kind of a bullseye here, this is a contour map, but instead of on the topography, it's on the upper surface of the Lompico. So that's where it's deepest. That's where you go down to it. So it's a sort of circular feature. And I'm going to show you some cross sections to illustrate that, where we go this way and then one that goes the other way. So just illustrating that. So this, you can see this sort of bowl-shaped thing with the Santa Margarita on top, the Aquitard of the Monterey, and the Lompico underneath, and the Butano there. And now next, if I think the next one I was going to do was D, across here, which is through the area of wells in the southern part of the district. And you can see, again, the folding in the Lompico and in the Butano, and sort of less folding in the younger rocks. But again, this little window here where it's a good place for water to go through. And finally, one that goes perpendicular to the others. And again, this kind of bowl shape, and it's, these rocks are being folded up against this granitic high. And it's this granitic high that prevents any water going into or out of our basin and into the adjacent basin of Mid-County. So what was the Sustainable Groundwater Management Act, which was signed into law in 2014? And basically, this was to halt widespread overdraft, and it requires local agencies to develop sustainability plans. It was basically a trade-off between one group of people that wanted the state to take stronger control of water rights and others that thought it should be local. So what they ended up with is they said, it's all going to be done locally, but you're going to have a lot of responsibilities. You can define what constitutes sustainability. You can tell us what plans are to reach it. But if you don't do it, then the state will step in if you fail to meet those milestones. And these laws will be done by new agencies called groundwater sustainability agencies, which have to be consisting of public agencies with water or land use authority. But that doesn't mean they can't make contractual agreements with other private entities. Okay, so you could, you know, make a contract with Mount Hermon or something like that if you wanted to. They also need to take input and take into the account the needs of all beneficial use and users of groundwater. So that would be other agencies, private well owners, industrial users, tribes, and environmental users, which in this case usually are aquatic and terrestrial ecosystems, and fish are the big one. And they have a surprising number of, I was shocked when I realized how much authority they potentially have. We have not wielded any of this in Santa Margarita yet, but you have a lot of tools in your command to get control over pumping, to make people contribute to getting towards sustainability. So the Department of Water Resources announced basin rankings in 2019 and said that any of them that were rated high and medium had to submit a groundwater sustainability plan, basically that would bring the basin into balance in 20 years and then be able to maintain it at sustainability for another 30. And you can see on this little map here, here we are. And of the basins, 21 of them were considered in critical overdraft. We are not. We're in this yellow color and we don't have the hatcher. But other basins near us were. So Mid-County, Pajaro Valley, and parts of Salinas Valley. And in their cases, and here it's because they have groundwater. The groundwater is becoming saline due to overpumping of the aquifers so that seawater has moved in underground and has essentially destroyed a number of the wells in Soquel and even ruined ones from Santa Cruz. So here's the timeline for our own Santa Margarita Groundwater Association. We created the Joint Powers Authority, and it consists of three agencies, San Lorenzo Valley, Scotts Valley Water District, and the County of Santa Cruz. It didn't have to be those. It was just that those three groups said they would work together. It could have had other people, but it didn't. And then that group received $1 million from the DWR as a grant to develop the GSP. They hired a facilitator to help with public outreach, and those things happened in early 2019 when they also executed a contract in the amount of $1.2 million for Montgomery and Associates to develop the GSP. So this is when really the work begins. So for the last 2 years, we've had monthly meetings of the board to hear presentations by staff and consultants in order to develop criteria for sustainability. In other words, what are the minimum levels that the groundwater table has to be at? What are the maximum levels of contaminants? And we're right here, and here are the things that have to happen really fast. The final draft is going to be presented to the Santa Margarita board shortly. And then based on those comments, they want to complete the draft and then let it out for public comment on July 30th for a month and a half, and then revise it based on that public comment. Then there's an official hearing, and then that is so it's in time to be submitted by the deadline of January 31st, 2021. And this has been coming, as Mark can point out, it's been coming on really fast at the end. The amount of reading has been almost impossible to do hundreds of pages a week, often of very technical stuff. And it's been a little frustrating in that regard. Okay, so who are the members? The directors, there's two kinds. There are member directors, which are, there are two of each, two each for each of the three organizations that are the founding ones. And then there are others that are just kind of regular members that represent other stakeholders in the basin. Two private well owners, one from Mount Hermon, one from the city of Santa Cruz, one from the city of Scotts Valley. And the point here is that no single person, no single group can take kind of over and decide the fate of the basin. Most decisions can be made by a simple majority of the 11-member board. However, on decisions on the budget, major expenses, and approval of the GSP, there has to be unanimity among the member directors. So these six people, in effect, have veto power. If I don't think I've ever seen it exercised, but it could be. So what is getting to sustainability all about? It's basically about avoiding six undesirable results, which are shown here. Lowering of groundwater levels, reduction in storm, I don't have to read them. You can read them. There's two of them that we don't really care about. One is seawater intrusion. And this is where, for example, this is the place where the groundwater table is below sea level in Soquel. And western part of Santa Cruz. And so the wells are all salty and have had to be abandoned. And this is just from drawing down too fast, so ocean water seeps in and now your well is bringing up brackish water. The other thing we don't have to worry about is land subsidence, which is a huge problem, for example, in parts of the Central Valley where there's been many dozens of feet. It's not a problem for us, because the rocks that I described that are our aquifers are all consolidated sandstones. So when the water goes out of them, the framework is still there. It does not collapse. And so we don't have to worry about that one. Okay, so I've crossed out those two, but we still have four we have to worry about. And I've written below, what are the things that are considered the sustainability indicators? In other words, what are you supposed to be measuring? The idea is that you have to have something that's quantitative, that you characterize. You know, you just can't say, oh, everything's honky-dory, or, oh gosh, we do have this kind of problem. You have to quantitate it by some way. And it's sort of logical that in the case of lowering of groundwater, it's the water levels in the wells and degraded quality of water. It's the measured contaminant levels. And in surface water depletion, it's how surface water, how well it's flowing, the vigor of vegetation around it, and the health of aquatic organisms. So let's go through the first one, the lowering of groundwater levels. And this is just superimposed on this map. This is just kind of it's very bright and lively. It just basically shows pumping for the interval from about 1990 to 2015. The pink is in Scotts Valley. The blue is the San Lorenzo wells, and this is Mount Hermon. And you can see how there's this kind of very rapid ramp up in, especially in Scotts Valley, that corresponds to when there was fairly rapid growth in Scotts Valley. But you know, there's also fairly rapid growth in our area too, in terms of the amount of pumping that was done. And so, if you look at the hydrographs, that is the measurements of the level of the water table in those wells through time, you can see here that they've been declining dramatically so in the southern part of the basin, not so much in the northern part. And so now I'm just going to go through quickly and take a kind of visit each one of the aquifers. And what this map shows is it's kind of stripped away everything else but to show that particular aquifer, which is in this case the Santa Margarita is in yellow. It's the youngest aquifer. It's covered here by younger rocks locally. And you can see that these are from 1980 to 2018. And there's maybe a little bit of a decline, but it's not very much in those in the Santa Margarita. And that's because it's exposed at the surface, so it recharges very quickly. And it's highly permeable, so any rainwater that falls on it easily falls in. Now, on this graph and all the other graphs, you'll see there are these like vertical lines that are colored. And yellow is normal rainfall years, blue are wet years, and the orange is dry, and the pinkish orange or purpley orange is extremely dry. And so you can just watch these as they go through. So here's the Monterey Shale, which, as we said, was not an aquifer. It's mostly an aquiclude between the Santa Margarita and the Lompico. But it's important because it's used by a lot of private well owners that tap sandy layers in the lower part of the formation, especially around here and up in here where it's exposed at the surface. And here you can see that the Monterey shale in this particular well has, the water level has dropped significantly, about 200 feet over this interval from 1980 to about 1997, where it bottoms out. And then you see this sort of slight recovery since. And the reason that recovery is fairly slow is that this rock is very impermeable. So even if it has water trying to get in, it takes it a while to get in. But at least we stopped here and we're going the other way. The Lompico is the most important of our aquifers because we use it in the southern system and because the Scotts Valley uses it as well. And again, what you can see is it is being drawn down more so in the south than in the northern part of Scotts Valley. And if we look, we can see here that since 1980, there's been a 215-foot drop in the water level. Here, it seems to have bottomed out somewhere around 2015, both in their well and our well here. And then it's kind of come back up since. And that slight recovery since 2015 is encouraging, because what that means is that we're finally no longer overdrafting. We're more or less in balance. The problem is that we've now drawn down the water table here, so we don't have as much of a buffer if there's an extended drought. And I do want to say something about population growth. I notice, and water use, and I notice that Scotts Valley tends to be demonized on this, and they're, everybody says evil things about it's their growth that's causing the problem. And it's really not entirely the case. Here is the plot of population of Scotts Valley with time from 1985 to 2020. And you can see it's going up. And yet, during that interval, yes, their amount of water they were pumping goes up, but so did our water here, shown in green. But sometime around here, around 2000, it starts going the other way. And that's largely due to better conservation efforts and the fact that a lot of the buildings that are being put in Scotts Valley are modern. And so they have very strict rules, and there's more townhomes and condos and things that don't have gardens in them. So actually, Scotts Valley's use has declined over time. And if you looked at it at a per capita basis, it would be even more so. Also, I should point out that this is only the pumping south of Bean Creek, so it's in the southern part. Most of the San Lorenzo Valley water groundwater pumping is north of Bean Creek in Olympia and Quail Hollow. So this doesn't really capture all of our groundwater use. And then finally, the Butano, sometimes it's Butano, sometimes it's Butano, we really only have a couple of wells. They're not very good because they're also screened in the Lompico, so it's not really sure whether these measurements are of the Butano or if they're only both. But it's an important aquifer, and it's especially important right up here where it's exposed at the surface, and a lot of private well owners take advantage of it up there. So when we set what are called the minimum thresholds and the measurable objectives for these, we had a lot of discussion about these at the Santa Margarita. And fundamentally, the minimum threshold we decided on was kind of like do no harm. Don't let it get any worse than it has been in the recent past. And so usually we took like an average of some of the better values that have happened in the recent past. And as far as measurable objectives, this is where you would like the groundwater levels to be, but they're kind of weird because they're not actually enforceable and they have to be achievable. So you get in this weird discussion about, well, should we be aspirational and, you know, say we want to recover everything that happened since 1985 or 1980, which is probably almost impossible, or should we do something that's readily achievable? And I think we tilted more in the direction of readily achievable. But between that, between the minimum threshold and the measurable objective is kind of where, you know, you have operational flexibility to deal with basically droughts or, you know, things going wrong with equipment. But the idea is that over time, slowly, you're going up towards the measurable objective. So in setting those, we took into account that sort of different things, that the Santa Margarita has this different behavior than the Lompico and the Butano do. And that Santa Margarita recharges so quickly in wet years. You can see how it goes up during the blue ones very quickly. And similarly, it goes down fairly quickly in dry years. And this is because it's highly permeable and widely exposed at the surface. The Lompico, on the other hand, recharges more slowly because very little of it's exposed at the surface. It's not as permeable. And in fact, you can sort of see that in these plots, right? So in other words, there's times when it dips is when they're taking out a lot of water in the summer, and then it sort of recovers in the winter a little bit, and then it goes down, basically because they're pumping out water faster than water can move into the wellheads because the permeability is not as high as it is in the Santa Margarita. So we sort of set different ideas on how to do these, and I'm not going to go over the details, but one important thing to recognize is that we're emphasizing the Lompico because it's an important aquifer across the basin. And modeling has shown that if you get the Lompico to go up, it causes all boats to rise. In other words, some of the water flows out of the Lompico into the Monterey. Some of it goes down into the Butano. Even some of it locally, if it's downhill, will go into the Santa Margarita, although that just leaks out again because Santa Margarita is like a leaky bucket. So all of our efforts are going to be focused on trying to get the groundwater levels in the Lompico to come up. Okay, reduction in storage. This is kind of a weird one because at least I thought it was weird initially, like what the heck does that mean? And I finally realized that why that's important is, this is the drought you can't see. It's the fact that underneath the ground, we're being able to store less and less, we're storing less and less water. And the reason this matters more than just water levels is if you think about it, if you have kind of a poor aquifer, that doesn't have a lot of pore space, you can, for any unit of water that you pull out, the well level will go down, even though you haven't really extracted a lot of water. If you're in the Lompico or the Butano, these are huge units, they're very thick, very extensive, and so there what you care about is not so much if the level goes down 10 feet or more, but how much you're losing in storage, because it's that storage that gives you the drought, basically the buffer. And to figure that out, you have to figure out the balance between inflows and outflows in the system, and that's the change in storage. And doing this requires a geohydrologic model for the valley, which is what the consultants spent a lot of time doing, is reworking the previous Kennedy and Jenks one to fix some of the errors, or not errors, but just slight differences in them. And so you have inflows and outflows that you have to take account of, and many of them are actually kind of hard to figure out or estimate with any accuracy. But on this diagram, you can see that, again, when we're talking about storage, and I apologize for these little scruffy little diagrams, but when I took it from the PowerPoint, they didn't put them all to the same scale, and so it made it look like the Monterey Formation had these big changes and the Santa Margarita did, but when you scrunch them all back so that all three of these are at the same scale, what you can see is that the biggest dives are in the Lompico, and especially in the Lompico in the Paso Tiempo, Camp Evers, and Scotts Valley area. So this is the area that if we're going to do any projects, we're going to really want to focus on. Degraded quality. This one has been pretty easy because the quality of the groundwater in the basin is pretty good naturally. There, occasionally you bump up against the iron and manganese and even the arsenic secondary maximum contaminant levels, but not usually. Usually dissolved solids are below these levels up here as well. And I would note that the municipal operators always treat the groundwater to remove any naturally occurring iron and manganese. Mostly this is an aesthetic question as much as a health one. And we can see here another potential contaminant is nitrate. And as nitrogen, measured as nitrogen, we're below the 10 milligrams per liter MCL in all of our groundwater and in all of the surface waters. Despite the fact that we have a lot of septic tanks, all these purple dots are septic tanks, and they're usually discharging, you know, into the shallow aquifer. It is true that by the time the San Lorenzo River makes its way all the way through Felton and gets downstream some more, it does start to have nitrate problems, and this is a nightmare for this city of Santa Cruz because it makes the water more expensive to treat, but it's not really a problem for us in the basin. So in setting the minimum thresholds, we basically just take, okay, you know, we're not going to ever let it get worse than what the legal thresholds are. And we take measurable objections are things that are perhaps, you know, kind of some of the better measurements that we've gotten in recent times. Finally, there's a surface water depletion. This one is the trickiest one to deal with, and it's pretty obvious what it is. You have open water locally in little ponds and bottoms of quarries. You have rivers and creeks, springs, and then there's other groundwater dependent wetlands where, you know, for example, here's the Olympia quarry floor where there's no water exposed, but the trees and willows and things, are roots are reaching down to the groundwater system. So to study these, it's pretty easy to figure out, like, okay, what do you do with the rivers? You just go and check out the rivers. What's a little bit more confounding is what do you do with these, what are called groundwater dependent ecosystems? And that would be the little springs in purple here, they're scattered about. Little bits of open water, which are sometimes man-made ponds, usually man-made ponds, and other groundwater supported wetlands, which are usually just places where there's shallow groundwater. So what you do is you try to identify those, and then you go and look in areas where there's a lot of pumping. So here's the municipal pumpers are here, and then there's a lot of private pumpers in these areas, and try to figure out whether they have any effect on the water. And it turns out that this is really hard to do. And one of the features of how streams are related to the groundwater table is what are called gaining and losing streams. So some streams, as they go downstream, because the water table slopes towards the stream, all the water, groundwater, is essentially flowing towards the river and is adding to the river or creek as it flows. In other places where the groundwater table is below the level of the creek, there, it's the opposite. The creek is losing flow and is going into, and is essentially recharging the aquifer. Usually what will happen is upstream from this, there'll be a different situation where there'll be, it'll be a gaining stream above that gives us all this water. And then there's weird cases where it's not attached in any way, in which case they don't consider it a groundwater dependent ecosystem and you don't have to worry about it. The important thing to realize for streams, and this really comes into the whole issue of minimum flows are important for fish, is that this base flow of water flowing out of the groundwater table into streams is basically all that's there in the driest part of the year. They're essentially, they are the cause of all the water in the streams. This is for Bean Creek, and you can see these spikes, which are individual storms, right, where the flow in Bean Creek was much higher. So you have storm flow, say from November until June, but then from the beginning of June until October sometime, it's almost all base flow. And so this is why it's important to know whether any pumping you're doing might be affecting base flow. When you're measuring streams, we have a number of places where there are already continuous read stream gauges shown on this map. And the other thing you have to do besides measuring them remotely like this is you also have to do studies where you go up, measure the flow, how deep the water is, you measure the concentration of dissolved solids, because often that is a measure of groundwater getting into the stream, and observations about the vigor of the plants near it and also the animals, measuring the amount of fish and other critters that you find there. Another aspect of this is that there's something that is important in terms of designing what are your kind of unreasonable results, is that there has to be significant adverse impacts to the viability of individual priority species or groundwater dependent ecosystems, or undue financial burden to beneficial users or uses of the surface water. And really, it comes down mostly to fish, the lamprey or fish. The golf courses are going away, most of the quarries are shut down, they would have been ones that were using this water. And so we have to worry about whether anything we're doing affects fish. And particularly, I concerned about steelhead trout. I got a little miffed when the coho salmon gets trotted out because it hasn't been seen up in our area for a long time. And it's basically at the very, it is, this has always been at the very southern extent of its range. And with climate change, I think it's going to be a kind of a quixotic thing to try to save the coho salmon here. So the challenges for quantifying stream flow depletion caused by groundwater use is basically you have to model it. You can't actually measure it because there's no dye in the groundwater that's coming out and telling you that it's contributing to the creeks or not. And there's a lot of other things that contribute to that stream flow, including precipitation, temperature, evapotranspiration, stream diversions. And sometimes you don't know whether it's pumping or whether, so for here's an example of where it's natural. So for example, there's a stretch of Bean Creek here that often goes dry in the summer, and it's geologically controlled. It's not because we're pumping somewhere, I don't think. It's basically, it happens exactly where the stream drops from the low permeability Monterey Formation into the high permeability Santa Margarita. And so the water just poof goes right down below the surface because it drops down. And then as it comes back around down here into the, towards the, where it meets up with the San Lorenzo River, you have the opposite that actually has seeps coming out. And here it's a gaining stream, not because there's no pumping here. It's because now the water that was seeping through the Santa Margarita here hits the impermeable Monterey below and can't keep going, and so has to come out as a spring or a seep. So you can have these kinds of changes that have nothing to do with pumping, so it makes it challenging. Here's an example of a modeled Bean Creek watershed stream flow contribution that they did to try to figure out the effect of pumping. And so the green is, this is basically modeling the stream flow in Bean Creek at the driest time of the year in October. And historically from 1985 to 2018. The green is contributions of base flow to the creek, because right at this time of year there is no stream, there is no storm flow. And if basically the private well pumping that is in this area would reduce the contribution to Bean Creek by only 0.06 CFS. It's really trivial. If you were to stop all pumping in the basin, all mutual, you know, us, everybody, it would cause it to drop by 0.46 cubic feet per cent. So that's this here, which is about 15% of the flow. And so the question is that enough? You know, does that make a difference for the fish? Well, probably 15% does. At this time of year, potentially it could, but there's no way we're going to ever stop all pumping. So the question is, you know, if you decrease pumping by 20%, is it enough to really make a difference for the GDEs and the fish? And this is the kind of thing that it's really hard to, I have found it's really hard to be confident in the modeling that, you know, you can get it down to that precision that you can really make hard decisions about things. So ironically, the way we measure how much groundwater is going into streams or whether pumping is affecting them is by drilling another well. So you stick a monitoring well in between where your production well is and where the stream is or a swamp or whatever. And the idea is if the groundwater level is high and it's sloping towards the river, that means the groundwater is adding to the stream. And you should be able to see that slope between the water level in the top of the pumping well, the monitoring well, and here. On the other hand, if you pump this too much, what happens is you draw this down now, and now the slope is the other way. So what happens is stream water would be going into the aquifer. And what you should now see is that should be detectable in the monitoring well. So for that reason, there's six shallow wells have been proposed to monitor groundwater interactions with surface water around a variety of places. There's also been three deeper wells in areas with abundant private wells where there's no monitoring at all, one deep well in the Butano so we have more data on it. And Santa Margarita Groundwater Association has obtained a grant that will pay for the majority of these costs for installing these wells. So here's the average modeled groundwater budget when you put all this stuff together. And the interesting thing it shows is that the basin is closed. It's hardly any goes out, hardly any comes in. And the outflows from the groundwater that you can see here, that discharge to creeks is 85% of it. Only 15% is pumping, which, you know, is kind of not one of those things you would have thought intuitively, right? That pumping is not the biggest thing. And then the things that are returning flow are a wide range of things, but the biggest ones are stream bed recharge, so places where the water goes the other way into the back down in, and just recharge from precipitation. So that's why precipitation, you can see here, 57% of what's going in. So it drives all of the modeling that you do. It's the big dog in terms of trying to figure out what happens. In many ways, more important than what you're pumping. I think I'll just skip this one. An interesting thing that comes out of this that I didn't realize was that septic systems are a good thing in a way. and we're lucky to have them here in San Lorenzo Valley because they return a lot of water to the groundwater aquifer. It's one reason that the Scotts Valley part of the system is not as well off in terms of groundwater, because they put all of their sewage in a sewer system that pumps all the water out of the system. It also shows that actually residential landscape use is not all that big of a deal. Some of it goes back in. It goes back in because sometimes we're inefficient. We water more than we need to. Here, it also shows that water system losses, these are the leaky pipes and leaky tanks, are a non-trivial amount of water that goes back into the systems. So one of the things that Santa Margarita requires you to do is address climate change. And it says this explicitly, that you have to use some kind of climate model along with some kind of water budget. And that you also have to take account of climate when you're coming up with your 50-year planning horizon for getting to sustainability. And these models, which started in the 70s, have gotten more and more complex with time as we've added more and more features to them, as we're modeling more and more complicated things, so that they're now they're like incredibly expensive to run on supercomputers because they have so many things interacting. The other thing is that over time, they have gotten, their resolution has gotten better. So for example, now you can find a small part in England, whereas before, basically you had all of the UK in one square. So now we've got better resolution models too. The model you choose is really important for doing this modeling. And this is a comparison of what, it's kind of an odd measure, the departure through 2070 of precipitation from historic average as a function of the model that you use. And these are some models that were used for different things. So the idea is that this is the average amount of rainfall that you have. So if the average amount of rainfall was constant, was always the average, and you stay on this line out forever. But if your rainfall levels are less, basically you'll drive it down this way. So you can see that the City of Santa Cruz Water Supply Advisory Committee used a model that had a huge decrease in the rainfall. The first model that we were given for Santa Margarita was the same one that they had used at Mid-County, but it was essentially what's a historical climate. Basically, you just say, well, this is kind of how things have been happening in the past, so we'll just kind of say that it's going to go along the same. But that means that it's not taking into account CO2 increases or other kinds of greenhouse gases. It's just basically saying, you know, kind of whatever happened in the past is just going to keep going. And I objected to that because all of the more recent science has suggested that if anything, rainfall is going to go up a little bit. And the reason is that we're near the coast. If it gets hotter, you evaporate more water off of the ocean. And so the rainfall is going to get maybe a little bit more, not very much, but a little bit more. It certainly is not going to drop 25%. Okay. And this is really important because if you think that the problem you have to solve is something, you know, that is like on this scale versus this scale versus this scale, it really changes what you're going to do for projects. And since we have now adopted what I think is a more realistic model in our round two, we sort of backed off from some of the more really expensive, huge projects because it doesn't look like we're going to need them. So the thing that this model that we're using, it's called an ensemble. It's an average of four models. And it basically has the precipitation is highly variable, which is what all the new good models suggest. And that evapotranspiration will go up because of increasing temperatures. If you use this model, this is what it tells you about the storage into the future by 2012, storage in the Lompico, that we've lost that much. So even with the new models, we're still losing storage in the Lompico, especially in the southern part of the basin, and we're losing some in the northern part. With the older models, it was way worse, but we still have something we have to fix. So how do we do that? And here are the kinds of things you can do to manage your aquifers and recharge them. One is called in lieu, which we've talked about before when we heard about conjunctive use. And that is that basically somebody gives you surface water so that you can rest your drawn down well because you're not using it. And then that allows the groundwater table to rise and stop drawing down in a way that it might affect these other wells here so that they don't get any water. So that's kind of a passive way of doing it in the sense that you're not actually pushing any water down there, but you're just letting natural rainfall and other recharge restore it. Then you can have active mechanisms where you either allow percolation of impounded surface or treated water to just sink into the shallow aquifers. Or you can do what's called ASR, aquifer storage and recovery. And the idea was that you'd take treated water that was injected into the deep aquifer. You have to treat it because the California law says you have to, because you don't want to muck up the aquifer with bad stuff, bacteria or weird chemistry. And so you add water there. And then the second idea was that later, when you need that water, so you put it down there in the winter, and then when you need it in the summer, you can pump it back out. Or maybe you don't do it every season. You pump some back in, and then you wait until there's an extended drought, and you take it out. Or maybe you do it even less frequently, that you just basically forget about this right-hand side of the recovery, and you just push water down there as a way to raise the groundwater table in there. Now, I've already explained how ASR works here. So one of the things that happens is when you put the water down there, you've got this water that you stored by forcing it in there. It's now mixed with the native groundwater that was in the rocks and the pores of the rocks. So you have kind of a mixed zone. And the change in the composition of the water that's in the pore space can cause reactions between groundwater and sediments. And one of the problems is, for example, here was a project that was undertaken recently in LA Basin. And what happened is that you take this highly oxygenated purified water and you sink it down into a layer that is reduced or anoxic. And what happens is pyrite that bears arsenic, that is fool's gold that's in the sediments, breaks down through oxidation and it releases the arsenic to come up into the water. You can also have other ways where you put, by changing the pH, you can destabilize hydrated iron coatings that arsenic had glommed onto. And if you destabilize those can, the arsenic can jump into the water and you can get these peaks in it. Then sometimes you can get that. And if the pH is just right, that you can restabilize, for example, here where you're breaking down the pyrite, but then you, the pH is okay, that you can then make clays, you actually end up with less arsenic than you did before. But the point is it's very variable. And in fact, the early tests on the Belts wells and ASR by Santa Cruz and SoCal have kicked up levels of arsenic that were above the MCLs. So this is something you have to worry about. Okay. So what are the projects that we're considering currently? There's basically three groups. One are the sort of things that we've been doing already. Another is the ones in orange are the ones that we're really studying the most. The group three are other projects that are not currently being investigated. These were the big ones that were kind of first trotted out largely by the city of Santa Cruz when it seemed like there was a real deficit that we needed to make up. And Santa Cruz realized that if there's a really big deficit, then you've got a big, essentially a big reservoir in the ground where you can store water. And that's Santa Cruz's problem, is they have a lot of water and no place to store it. And just for Bob's sake, the staff used this method for going over how the costs were estimated. And I'm not gonna go through this, but it's there, Bob, if you wanna read this later when I post it. So here are the tier one projects. The first ones are just kind of simple additional water use efficiency, you know, the usual outreach rebates. Also new smart meters, and the big cost is addressing the leaks in infrastructure so we don't lose, you know, I think what, Rick, we lose something like 200 acre feet a year to that, I think. That's a lot. The other is to do in lieu conjunctive use, as Carly described, where we just take things from the north system and the Fall Creek diversion points and send it to the south system to rest the Paso Tiempo wells in the Lompico. Then a little bit bigger one would involve doing that, but also taking our allotment of Loch Lomond water and using treated water from Loch Lomond to rest both our wells and potentially Scotts Valley Water District wells as well. And then the fourth one I'm not going to talk about because I thought it was kind of weird that it keeps coming back up, but it's the idea that anybody would pump water into a leaky bucket of the Santa Margarita just seems odd. And then these slightly bigger projects where they probably, instead of just locally benefiting us or Scotts Valley, here we use effluent from that's treated at the Pure Water SoCal, their new treatment plant, and injected into Scotts Valley wells in the Lompico. And then finally, the treat water from the city of Santa Cruz surface waters where they injected into the well, perhaps also in our south system to rest the wells and to provide a drought buffer for the city, a place they can store it for when they need it. In other words, they're not going to take it out all the time, but if they need to, they can do it. So one of the things we used the model for was to see, are these going to do the job, right? And so here's a model to show the levels of the Lompico aquifer in one of the wells. And we can see the baseline here is if you do nothing over time, you'll end up with it going below the minimum threshold, right? So something has to be done. It turns out if you do the in lieu recharge plus the Loch Lomond water, you pretty much stay above the minimum threshold, and you don't start to go down below this one here until, you know, pretty far out. If you're talking out in the 60s or 70s, you know, we've got plenty of time to worry about it. If we did these bigger projects, this would recover, you know, maybe half of what was lost during that large drop in groundwater in the 80s and 90s. This is to show what would happen in the Monterey Formation. Even though we don't use it as an aquifer and we're not putting water into the Monterey, it leaks out from the Lompico into the Monterey, which otherwise would be going down, 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 which would be problematic for private well owners, and makes that not go down as quickly. Okay. And of course, if we do a bigger project, we put more in there. The interesting thing is this is the plot. There's three lines here actually for Santa Margarita. So there's the baseline, and the two plots for the projects, right, plot virtually on top of it. And the reason that doing these projects do no good is because the Santa Margarita recharges itself in wet years, jumping up quickly here, and then going down a lot in dry years, but it comes back really quickly with a very short lag time. And also because this is such a leaky bucket, it's so fast that you just can't put water in fast enough to make it actually come up. Okay. And then the Butano, this is up here in the north end where all the private wells are. We're not having a project up here. Everything we're talking about doing projects is sort of downhill hydrologically. So it wouldn't be expected to affect anything up here, but this shows how those private well owners might be affected in this area, because we're not doing any projects to address that. It's gonna fall well below the minimum threshold. Here, where it's closer to where the projects are going to be done, the baseline again falls below the minimum threshold, but doing these projects bring it above. Okay, so this is the part that Bob always wants to know, and I wanted to know too, and I think Mark and I were anxious to know, and I've added two lines at the end there because I wanted to figure out how much water each of these projects would produce. And then there's kind of a weird metric, which is the annual operating costs are per acre feet of water. And now you might wonder why the operating costs. And the reason is that everybody tells me, and I will believe them, that it will probably be possible to get most of the capital costs paid for through grants. But what we're going to be on the hook for forever are these costs, the annual costs. And so what I've calculated here are how much it's going to cost per acre foot of water that are produced by these projects. And on this one, I had to, this, for some reason, they left off the upgrade that we'd have to make to the Kirby water treatment plant for if we took the Loch Lomond water. So I put a number in there. I don't know, Rick, I might be wrong, but it's just an attempt to, you know, put a placeholder in there.
That's about a half to a third of what it will actually be. Well, that number was valid in 2010. It's not.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, all right. So you can, if you want to pop that up, then that would make that number go up to 1500 or something, if that's what, you know, you want. It's certainly a lot cheaper than the water you'd get out of by putting water in a leaky bucket. And in many of these cases, there's a big cost is not the actual capital construction. For example, the in-lieu stuff, we've done most of the work. It's the legal fees, the land fees, the environmental stuff that has to be done, plus all of the costs that are associated with design, indirect construction costs, which are all lumped into here as well to get these total capital costs. So if we go up from tier one projects to the tier two, we can see that this is where the North Scotts Valley indirect potable reuse goes up to, you know, I don't know, three times as much as what the other two were. And these are the tier three that we've pretty much thought we aren't going to do right now because they are so costly. They also involve a lot of technology that may be, like, for example, the ASR stuff. We just don't know if it'll even work. And we may not need this much water in the near term. So we're not really talking about those now. So in my own view of this, I think it's pretty obvious, and I think Rick would agree, and I think Mark agrees, that the low-hanging fruit are these first three projects where they're relatively low in both capital costs and the O&M. And in many cases, the infrastructure is already in place, or at least it's fairly straightforward to plan for. There's no like weird things that could jump out at you and bite you later. And they also tend to benefit us the most in improving water levels in the Alampico and the area we care about, and it also secures our water supply the most. So that's just kind of my take on this, but that's only my opinion, and that isn't necessarily what the rest of the board members will think. But the important thing to realize is none of this is going to happen quickly because of environmental stuff and getting grants, and you know, it'll take a couple of years to plan even the simplest projects. And any of these bigger ones won't start until five years out. So it's not like we have to like stop the train now, because this is going to take a while to go. Then there's finally the cost of actually implementing the GSP that I thought I would mention. And this is the total annualized cost is, according to this estimate, $4,009 for every year for 5 years. And one of the things that is mentioned here where there's nothing in the budget is that now that we're starting to implement things, it might be the time to reconsider the structure and membership of the group. And this is the way the costs are right now divided between Scotts Valley, us, and the county. And the question is should those be changed going forward? The assumption is that the capital projects will largely be funded by whoever happens to build them. But should the membership of the Santa Margarita Groundwater Association reflect who's actually benefiting from all of this, and should they be taking up some part of the administrative and management aspect of the organization? And how will we make sure that there aren't any free riders? In other words, you know, we can't subsidize all the private well owners and you know, all the other people that will be getting a benefit, because if we put water into the Lompico and things get better in the Monterey or in the Butano. Then this also is, this is kind of the administrative side of it, which comes out to $163,000 a year. I really tend to dispute this number. I can't believe that once you start doing planning for these things that number won't be bigger, but maybe that can be subsumed into the capital plans of the costs. I'm more worried or more sure that this is an understatement. I think that what I know from how much all the consultants cost, this is a gross underestimate of what consultants are going to cost us. And also there's nothing in here for the anybody that's going to help think about refining projects, management actions, or coordinating among the agencies. The assumption is that we'll just pick that up extra with the staff. And then there's this one where there's $870,000 in consultant fees over 5 years to do monitoring of various types. And that's just, it's a lot. And that actually doesn't even include a lot of effort by our own staff, where there's zeros there and other places where there are, I think the assumption we've heard at Santa Margarita is that our staff can mostly pick this stuff up, but I don't see our staff sitting around. I just don't see how they can do some of these things. So anyway, if you just assume the $409,000 annualized cost, that would work out to $123,000 for us. And if there's an underestimate of consultant costs and maybe planning costs, maybe that number should be more like $174,000. So it's a non-trivial amount of money. So at that point, I'll stop and take any questions. And I guess I'd like input from the public and from the board about what balance do you think that Santa Margarita should strike between cost and getting all the information possible about interaction between surface waters and shallow groundwater in support of these groundwater dependent ecosystems and the fisheries. And I'd also like your thoughts on the structure of the membership and allocation of administrative costs and how we can minimize free riders. Okay, with that, I think I'm done. And let's see, how do I unshare? Oh, stop share. Okay. Great.
Did you want me to take over?
Or? Yes, I did, Lois.
Okay. So, all right. Any questions from board members or comments? It appears that Bob has his hand up. Is that a hand, Bob?
Yes.
Okay. So would you like to comment?
Well, I have a lot of comments, but I want to get questions out of the way first and hear all the questions from folks. Some of my comments may be addressed by the other question. So the first question, though, for Gail, I'm a little confused by what you mean. This, you seem to be creating a distinction between ASR and injection of wastewater or other water into Scotts Valley's wells. What's the difference between those? I mean, it seems to me like both of them are injecting water into
subsurface. I'm not really making any distinction about them. I mean, the term ASR implies the recovery part, right? And usually it implies when you say that you're taking the water out quickly annually. Most of the things that we're talking about here, where we're talking about injecting, is not to do it on an annual basis, summer, winter. But in terms of the, you know, the costs, I mean, the costs are less. One of the aspects of ASR is it has a terrible carbon footprint because you're using energy to stick the water down there and then you have to pump it out again. And so this is one of the, so in addition, that's why it's expensive, but it also is, you know, whereas in lieu, most of our in lieu, gravity does it for us, right? A lot of our system is downhill. So I'm not really making a big distinction. It's just that the larger term is managed aquifer recharge, right? And ASR is kind of one subset of it, but I'm not trying to make a big distinction about it.
Well, I guess though it looked like a large portion of getting stabilization and recovery of the groundwater basin had to do with some level of injection into wells. And maybe I misunderstood that, but it seemed like there was, in the projects that were being seriously considered, there was injection into wells.
Most of it was in lieu and potentially injecting some things in wells. But again, we're not talking about taking it out right away.
I'm not worried about the act of putting it in is expensive enough.
Yeah.
Typically, particularly if you have to drill new wells. Now, it wasn't clear whether we were talking about new wells or whether we're just going to use their existing wells and sort
of. I could answer that question. No, you cannot. for an ASR well, the diameter has to be considerably larger because you know you're trying to force all this water into the aquifer. So they're more expensive than your typical production well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you couldn't use the existing production well. So any kind of injection would require new wells.
Yes.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Maybe I misunderstood. Okay,
well, you know, in the grand scheme of things, you know, the wells are, you know, you start throwing large numbers around, but the wells are, we're not talking about, you know, drilling 25,000 feet into the, you know, in the Permian Basin or something. We're talking about wells that are going down hundreds of feet or something like that. So they're not enormously expensive wells.
Okay. And then my second question had to do with phasing. Was there any consideration given so far to the notion of phasing this in, where there'd be more of an immediate implementation of of the conjunctive use, where
Absolutely.
We're using extra surface water, and then we would measure things in a few years, and if we needed to do something, then we might go to something else.
That's absolutely right, Bob. That's what we would do. And even using the Loch Lomond water, a lot of that is in lieu, right? In other words, if we do the Loch Lomond, correct me if I'm wrong, Rick, but we'd have more water than we'd need a lot of the time. And we'd have water left to share with Scotts Valley. But that would be not, we're not injecting it. We're just allowing them to west their wells.
Yeah, I mean, the Loch Lomond water isn't free. So we have to pay Santa Cruz for it. And we then have to treat it using more expensive treatment technology.
Well, I mean, it was costed out in the thing there. And I mean, in a relative way. And of course, if we send it over to Scotts Valley, Scotts Valley will buy it from us, not at retail rates if it's in large quantities, but they will buy it.
I don't know why not retail rates, but so that costing out included the cost of purchasing the water from Santa Cruz?
I don't know. I'd have to go back and look at the details. Carly might know if she's still here.
Okay, I'll wait till later for the rest of my comments, but thank you on those questions. Those are pretty critical for me anyway.
Any other board members have any questions? Jamie, do you have any questions? No?
I'd like to hear what the public has to say first.
Okay, how about you, Mark?
Do you? Yes. To further expand on what Gail was saying and to lead into what you were asking, Bob, about the gradually phasing these projects in, yes, the first thing that's being considered is the in lieu of use, using existing surface water sources that the district currently has access to and at times during wet weather months is underutilizing, and being able to use that to rest wells more frequently, stepping up to one of the next being use of the water from Loch Lomond. And from the discussions that we've had with Rick, it's my understanding if we purchase the water from the city, we're purchasing treated water from the city.
Not necessarily.
No.
We can always purchase raw water. We tap into it by sampling away.
We can purchase raw or we can purchase treated.
We do not.
Treated, we need to get an interconnect between them to do that, right?
Right.
Yeah. Okay. All right. Got it.
At this point in time, Mark, we do not have an agreement with the city of Santa Cruz for treated water.
And right.
We'll talk about that further down the road as part of discussion of moving forward on conjunctive use and the benefits of treated water, but that's a discussion we need to have with the city.
Right.
Okay.
But great. That, doing that is years into the future. With using our surface water sources on a more regular basis first. And
yeah, I'm not sure, you know, years would, you know, I guess years would be three, but I think it could be done sooner than later.
Yeah. So
I don't think it's, you know, 10 or 15 years down. I think three.
I don't think it's that. I don't think it could necessarily have to be that far.
We're working with a concrete project and moving ahead.
Right. But it's those two that we would be looking at first rather than some of the much more significantly expensive options that Gail presented in the charts. And evaluating how the aquifers respond after we implement those projects. So good presentation, Gail. I learned from it. Thank you.
Gail, I thought it was a good presentation also. So I want to ask the board, those were questions. I'm sure some of you have comments. Do you want me to go to the public for their questions?
Yes.
Or do you want
yes.
Me to let you make your comments before I do that?
Well, let's get questions and comments from the public.
I think agreed.
Okay. All right. I can do that. So Are there any questions? Looks like Cynthia Denzel has a question. So Cynthia.
Yes, thank you for the presentation, Gail. It was way more than I could take in. But I hope that it's available as a recording so we can study it later. So my understanding is the ASR projects are really separate from, I mean, there are some that are part of SMGWA, but it's really City of Santa Cruz that is pushing for the ASR projects, particularly right now in their collaboration with Soquel. Is that correct? And the other question I have is in what you brought about the Kirby Street renovation not having been fully considered. That means that we don't really know the cost of that. And no one has considered apparently building a new treatment plant. And, you know, maybe that's pie in the sky, but I'd like to know, you know, I'd like to see that costed out and see what, you know, comparison with the cost of buying treated water from City of Santa Cruz. You know, I think that we should be aware of all the options. Thank you.
So Gail, did you have an answer for her first question?
I forgot what it was, sorry. you know, if Rosemary wants to answer that, that's fine with me. She's still here.
And I could answer.
Rosemary's here. Yes. Good. I don't see her saying.
She's here.
She's here.
Yeah, I see her, but I don't see her paw up.
Okay.
So Rosemary, are you there? And do you want to say something?
Put you on the spot.
You don't have to, but.
Okay.
Go ahead, Rick.
Yeah, well, you know, to Cynthia's questions, not this fiscal year, but in our annual budget, the second year, we do have funds to start the feasibility process of the Loch Lomond water. And one of the projects that we'll look at under that is buying treated water from the city. That's the preferred method, you know, operational wise. The city will have a state-of-the-art treatment plant that can treat the Loch Lomond, which is a lake water, surface water that's a little more difficult to treat than our streams. We would prefer to go in that route because we'd be able to pick that water up in the south system instead of moving it over from, you know, the north system over to the south. So there's still a lot of potential projects to look at with the Loch Lomond water, and a treated water project could be a very beneficial in partnering with other agencies such as Scotts Valley, who could utilize a treated water interconnection with the city as well. And that could we could share costs. So the feasibility study moving forward will look at many alternatives to the Loch Lomond water. And, you know, I agree with Cynthia, we need to look at all of those and do what's, you know, best for the Santa Rosa Valley Water District in water quality and cost.
So if there's no more questions from the public,
Jim Mosher,
I see your hand up.
Thank you, everybody. I appreciate the presentation. It went fast and furious, and it was hard for me to follow a lot of it, but there are two questions that come up for me in trying to absorb all this information. One is, it seems like it's odd to me that City of Santa Cruz isn't more involved in this process, particularly now we have the water rights issue. And it seems like they have a lot of interest in what's going on here, and they're pushing for certain solutions that may not be of best for us. I don't know, but it just seems like it's just odd that they're not more equal partner in trying to figure this all out. And I guess the other question obviously, if we can do this passively with recharge, that's obviously the best solution. And I'm just, I'm confused about the extent to which you think that that will be sufficient. What are the odds that we can just do this through recharge rather than having to do these injection wells that are so expensive?
Well, I think Mark made the point that this is going to be done in a sort of rolling manner in which we'll do the in lieu things first and see how the system responds. And, you know, the other thing that could happen too that I'm really struck by is that, you know, the best way to decrease pumping is to improve conservation. And, you know, that's the cheapest by far way to get more, you know, more water in the sense or not have as much problem with the groundwater. So I think that this will all be, you know, it's not going to happen fast. It will all just go at a pace where we can see what it's doing. Certainly the modeling shows that, those models are just kind of one potential scenario of the climate. So, you know, it could have happened another way, but it really looks like, you know, if the modeling is anywhere near correct, that probably some of these smaller projects are going to do the job at least for 10 or 20 years. And, you know, as long as we don't go hog wild with other stuff. So I'm optimistic that, you know, 5 or 10 years down the road, then we'll see, and maybe things will, you know, there'll be new technology, or we'll just see how things go. And of course, all of these climate models are highly uncertain. So, you know, we try to do the best we can with them, but because we have no choice, but they may not play out that way. So I think it's very likely that at least for 10, maybe 15 years, that I'd be surprised if we need to go to anything that involves injection, and that we can probably do almost everything by in lieu. The only problem with in lieu, and this was something that I was reading a report that Nick Johnson wrote, who's a really smart guy as a hydrologist, and he said the problem with in lieu is you're limited in how much you can do by the winter demand, right? So in other words, because the demand drops down so low in the winter because people aren't watering their gardens or, you know, washing their swimming trunks or whatever. You can only do so much within lieu because of that. And that's why you start to think about, well, if that doesn't do the job, you're going to have to think about injection, where you can take that extra flow if you've got it, and you don't just let people, if it's beyond the demand, you have to do something with that water. And so there may be a situation where that would happen. And that's why I'm saying I don't consider those ASR in the sense of put it in, take it out, put it in, take it out. I consider those more where you would just go in and inject it with the idea that it would just stay there and be essentially a drought buffer. I think that's what, you know, Mark and I have sort of talked about this, and I think it's fair to say, Mark, that we're not in a total panic about this. I think we both feel that, you know, we don't have to do anything dramatic or especially costly right away, but over the long haul, over 20 or 30 years, the way things are going with climate is that we will need to do something. We just can't stand around, and that we need to start thinking about that now. And is that fair to say, Mark?
Yes, but I think you're alluding to...
We still have two people from the public showing here.
You're alluding to
interrupt.
Okay, you've got the meeting, Lois.
Okay, Jim Mosier, were you done with your questions? because you still had your hand up.
I just wanted to respond if you want to go to some other questions. I wondered in terms of this issue of the winter, you know, losing people not having so much demand. I know that in many, at least in Portland, where I was up with a friend, they were having neighborhoods and local people do specific things to try to hold some of that water. And I wondered if that can be part of the picture. I mean, we actually had someone come up to our property and tell us how we could use some of the extra flow from our water tanks to try to replenish the aquifer by holding it in various places on our property where it would more likely seep than end up flowing down to the river. So maybe are there some things that we could be giving homeowners and landowners options for how we could improve the storage of the water in the winter so that it's not all flowing down the river? I don't know much about this, but I thought that was another.
I think that, you know, it's one of those things that sounds good and we should all try it. But one of the things that Scotts Valley did was they built, you know, as you probably know, these parking lots that have pervious surfaces so that they could, water could go down. And it's just a really expensive way of recharging the aquifer because the amount of water that goes down is, you know, like a few acre feet. I mean, it's ridiculous. So this is not, it's not a practical way of getting the kinds of volumes of water that you need to supply things. You know, it sounds nice, it's just not practical, and it's more expensive than the things that we're talking about in terms of acre feet produced or saved. Sorry to say, it's not, you know, don't you wish it would be so?
April, you have your hand up.
Yes, thank you. I really appreciated Gail's presentation with all of those slides, although they went by rather quickly. It gave me a sense of the overall complexity of these projects. And I'm glad that we're going to have several monitoring wells. We might over time want more. The better of a job that the district can do on collecting the data, and as climate models improve over time, the better of an idea we're going to have about what we need to do in the future. So I applaud your efforts in capturing the scientific data that we're going to need to get through this.
Thank you, April. Any other members of the public who wish to speak? I see a hand up. Mark Lee. Mark Lee, did you have your hand up? Oh, he took it down. Okay.
I'm still here.
Oh,
okay.
Okay.
Yeah, so I appreciate, did you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, so I said that I appreciate the technical report that Gail has put together. I understood every bit of it and taken many courses in hydrology and geology at Davis. From my background in environmental planning. So I understood it completely. I have reservations though on ASR. I've read a lot of technical information where there are exorbitant costs involved in annual operations and maintenance. They cave in, especially in the certain soil types, and they're very expensive. One thing I need to point out to you, all of you, this is all related to the EIR that none of you have read, that we're about to make a decision on and negotiate through Gina's letter, which I think we need to make sure that we include a stipulation that we maintain some control during the months of July and September during this, in her final proposed language under term 13. Regarding you requested, Gail, my interpretation of who should have the percentage of representation. Since we're only 7,200 ratepayers in the area, I think our membership should percentage should go down to 10 or 15%, whereas the city's absorption of costs should actually increase with the county, because they're the benefactors of all this water that we're going to be sending their way. A lot of water. And if you read the EIR, you're going to find that the money, the water that they want is going to the Soquel Creek ASR programs and projects, which you got to review in terms of acre feet that they need. They're still projecting literally a 1.2 billion gallon per year deficit. So I would say reduce our percentage to 15% of responsibility on SMEGWA and increase the percentages formally with City of Scotts Valley, City of Santa Cruz, and the county. I was shocked that we never had three members on the voting panel, and we only have two. So that kind of was a, I think.
Okay, thank you. I see a hand up. Is that still?
Jamie has her hand up.
No, I mean, okay. But I think we ought to go back. I'm sorry, Jamie. I think we ought to go back to Mark, who started to answer your question. So I want to take it back to you, Mark.
Okay. I'm not sure what the question is at this point. So I will defer an answer at this point. But thank you, Lois.
Okay. So, Jamie, it's all yours.
So, you know, we have a lot of big questions in front of us in terms of, you know, investment and governance and the structure of the board. And I guess I'd like to hear from Gail. You know, one of the speakers raised the question of whether or not the City of Santa Cruz should be in any way financially responsible. You know, they're not currently a member, you know, so I guess, you know, well, they are currently a member with one district or one representative, but I guess I'm just trying to understand, like, what we recommend, whatever decisions we come to as a body in terms of our recommendations about how we would like to see this process unfold going forward, what kind of weight does that carry with the rest of the Santa Margarita board in terms of, you know, how you make these next decisions?
Well, I guess I would say is I'm not asking anybody to make any decisions right now. I'm just trying to, you know, I'm basically trying to do my job here as a representative of the district to kind of let you know the state of play. I don't think there's any urgency on changing, you know, these things. I think that who was it that said it? Oh, Jim Mosher said it was odd that Santa Cruz wasn't a member. That was exactly my response too. It's very odd. And I, you know, I'm not sure, you know, and I wasn't around when this was invented, and I'm sure there was some political reason for why it happened. And, but it's a very strange situation to have a process that is largely driven by the staff of the county and the City of Santa Cruz. And yet, you know, we're paying for a lot of it, and this is partly my concern. And it's not evilness on their part. It's just partly because they're bigger. You know, they have more staff, they have more budget, and the two people that you might think would be involved in this, Carly and Rick, you know, they've got this little thing called the CZU fire that they've had to kind of deal with all of the capital things that are associated with that. So I think it's pretty understandable that, you know, they haven't had as much of a role as some of the other people have. And it's part of my frustration is I often feel like we're kind of, how should I put it? We're sort of outgunned. You know, I admire them, but I just feel like it's hard to get our point of view across because we do only have two representatives and you know, Scotts Valley in effect has three because they've got a person that's a, you know, from the city council that's also on there. So, you know, it's just a little odd, as Jim said. You know, I'm not suggesting I know the answer to it. It's just, I think at some point Bob wrote an article in the paper saying that, you know, he kind of implied that, you know, Mark and I weren't paying attention to people in the board. And I think that's really quite wrong. And I think that we've worked really hard to try to defend the the interests of the district. And in fact, I think I've made myself into virtually a persona non grata with most of the people at Santa Margarita in that regard. So
I agree with that.
I can attest to that too, actually.
So this is just the very beginning of a conversation. I don't expect any answers. I just want people to start thinking about it, right? There's no rush. And I just want people to think about it and to eventually give their thoughts and opinions. And maybe you'll have the right questions to ask, right? You know, what matters to you about thing.
You have your hand up.
Yeah, thanks. And before I get into my comments, I just want to clarify something about governance. So the governance of this is very clear. Mark and Gail do not answer to the San Lorenzo Valley Board of Directors. I think that was the only point that I was trying to make, is that they're independent voices on the Santa Margarita Groundwater Agency. Now, they do have expansive discretion with respect to the use of their vote, including the veto power. But the San Lorenzo Valley Water District Board of Directors did not direct them in what to do. I that was the only point I was trying to make, Gail. Not that you guys aren't doing your job or somehow not paying attention. It was just a statement of fact about the governance model. Am I not correct about the governance model?
Well, I mean, in the sense that we are appointed by usually, you know, somebody on the board president, it's not like we just are running amok.
But there was no implication of running amok. It was simply a statement of fact about governance. The governance is we five could take, let's just take a theoretical point of view. We five, three of us could take a vote to tell you and Mark to do something and you could ignore it. You're not directed by us, other than perhaps through politics or whatever else, but there's no direct authority of the San Lorenzo Valley Water District other than your appointment relative to how you vote. And I think it's important that people understand that from the point of view of governance. I find that very odd myself, by the way. There's a lot of odd things about the groundwater agency. And that is one of the other odd things about it. Anyway, before I go, but I wanted to make sure that was clear, because I'm not, you're making it sound like I'm accusing you of Mark of dereliction of duty, and that wasn't the point at all. I sort of approached this from sort of three do's and three don'ts in terms of Santa Margarita, you know, philosophy, in terms of what we're trying to get to. Do make it simple. We're just too small in this area to do anything complex like an ASR or a lot of that stuff. Do take Scotts Valley up on their statements that they really don't need a lot of assistance, that they've stabilized their use and they don't expect it to go up very much at all. And do, to the extent necessary, sell excess water if they need it, but it doesn't really sound like they needed it. The don'ts were, don't do injection of any kind, too expensive and we're too small. Don't create expensive bureaucracy. $200,000 contribution from us a year is $25 per subscriber per year. That's the tax that goes into keeping Santa Margarita alive. And don't torture the well owners by creating an expensive and complicated process for them to have to deal with. I continue to be concerned about statements on conservation, and I think we need to be very clear in what we mean by that. Our customers currently use, if you take wintertime use, we talked about this at a previous meeting, you take wintertime use and you divide, you know, do all the divisions, we come out between 38 and 42 gallons per person per day indoor use.
That is almost 20% below the ultimate state goal. So the question that I would have for everybody is, what is the gallons per day goal that we expect people to continue to drop to for indoor use? And if the indoor use is not where we're focused, then we should basically make that very clear, that what we're really talking about here is outdoor use, and not so much, again, continuing to sort of, you know, beat on people about their indoor use. We are currently—
Bob?
Yep.
Could we talk about Santa Margarita here?
We're talking about it with respect to conservation.
I know that, but you're talking about our indoor use.
It's all wrapped up. If we're going to make conservation a large portion of this, then we need to be very clear about what those goals are and what we expect people to do. Because right now, I don't think we're giving mixed messages to our customers. I very much support the idea of a phased-in approach. I think that we should not have any commitments in the GSP for anything beyond the water sharing, in lieu, conjunctive use, perhaps Loch Lomond. Beyond that, let's run it for a period of time, see how it goes, and then if we need to make adjustments, do that. But including it in there as a commitment, even if it's years in the future, that means it's still something that people ultimately may have to pay for. And I don't think any of the injection solutions are ever going to be affordable. I think there are other technologies that will come down the road that will help us over time that we don't have right now. But I just don't see injection, because of physics and science and all the other things, as ultimately being a great solution.
Just let me say one thing about that, is that, there is no commitment. That's one of the peculiar things about the GSP, is that you put out ideas about how you think you could solve the problem, but there is absolutely no commitment on the part of the organization to actually doing them. And I think that maybe the reason that they did that was that they wanted people to kind of blue sky think and don't get overly worried about penny pinching from the beginning. But you know, if there's something in there about doing injection or whatever, it does not mean that we ever have to go there.
Well, bureaucracies change over time as well relative to their regulations. So if they get an idea that you think it might be feasible, or it might be something you're considering, over time that might actually morph into something that wasn't intended to start with, which is my big concern on that. Because for a small district like ours, even a small contribution is going to be unaffordable for our community. Thanks.
That it, Bob? Are you done? Okay, Mark, do you have something to say?
No, I don't have any further comments. No,
the other Mark.
I'm sorry. I was talking to Mark Smalley, not you, Mark Lee, and the board's talking right now. I'm not talking to the community at the moment. Thank you.
So. Okay, that's what I understood, Lois, and thank you for that. I don't have any further comments at this point. Thanks.
Do I get to make a comment?
I think certainly.
I'm totally against injection wells. There's no proof they work. And I also feel like more people should be involved in paying for this besides just the three. Scotts Valley, SLV, and the county. The other comment I'd like to make is, having been on this committee, and now Gail and Mark are on it, we are always looking to represent SLV. I mean, we know pretty much what people think in SLV. It doesn't mean we can ignore everybody else, but we are looking at the needs of SLV. At least I think that's what Lou and I were doing, and I think that's what Gail and Mark are doing, but they aren't ignoring other people in the process. So that was my comments. So if there's no more comments from the board, Mark Lee has his hand up. I could go out to the community. Is that okay with everyone?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay, Mark Lee, speak.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you for the presentation. That I was very enlightening. I hope that we will lower our cost percentages and participation and our requirements on SMEGWA. It's a large responsibility at 30%. And hopefully that we'll be able to change the rules of the MOA that that everyone is a member of, and see if we can modify that to give us a better leverage, because any type of projects anticipated, even if they're test pilot projects, need to be paid for by other agencies that have better benefits from it. So that's what my recommendation is. And please, in the letter that goes to the city regarding the EIR, please put some teeth into it that actually defines the amount of use during the months of use, allowing for the diversion of variance, because we know when we need our water and when we have too much water. And so I don't mind sharing, but we don't want to give away the farm. Two times the existing 1940, the 1940 permit seems like a lot of money and a lot of water that's going to them. And they already have water rights on the San Lorenzo River and Loch Lomond. Yeah, it's going to be really hard to determine how much water we really need when it gets really hard, really hot here, and we get in global warming continues and it gets really bad. And we have another, heaven forbid, any type of fire or anything. So we need to make sure that we control water, in abundance for the people that are actually paying for the staff members that Rick Rogers manages, okay, and the facilities that we can get done within a time frame based on a capital facilities plan that makes sense. We don't have to do everything all at once, just the most important capital facilities projects that are actually going to protect us from fire, and also the 5-mile plan. So I don't think we should kowtow to the city of Santa Cruz. Thank you.
Okay, I do not see any other, Cynthia?
I just wanted to ask whether anyone has considered that with climate change, we may have many new members of the district, through these small mutuals and private well owners wanting service from SLV Water District, just as Big Basin found that they couldn't handle the problems from the fire. If we have future fires, we may have other people. Also, the increased regulation is going to force people to ask for our assistance. And I'm wondering if that is part of the consideration of SMEGWA, that the existing water districts would be absorbing new people. Also, I believe the well owners are asking for education, so that they know how to manage their wells and septic systems to avoid contamination and ruining their wells. you know, we, SMGWA can perform a larger duty of education to the broader public, all of the people who are, you know, dependent on the same basin, but may not have access to the same information that the board of SMGWA has. Like your presentation, Gail, would be really valuable to everyone in the area, not just ratepayers of SLV. Thank you.
Gail, did you want to respond to that? Okay, I don't see any. Oh, Mark Lee, I'm not letting you talk again. So put your paw down. Thank you. Okay, Gail, I'm going to turn this meeting back over to you.
Okay. Well, I think you're just doing fine.
You want me to finish?
Well, I was just going to say that I would put forth a motion to adjourn.
Okay. If no one has objection, I'll make a motion to adjourn.
Do we do that normally?
No.
No.
I was just encouraging her.
Aye.
Okay. We are adjourned.
Yay. Thank you, Lois.
Thank you, everyone.
Okay, good night.
Bye.
Thank you.